1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. It's me,
wait,
stupid.
What just happened? I don't know.
Whatever.
I forgot that game.
Yeah,
okay.
It's whatever. Okay. You look really pretty today, Beverly.
Really?
Yes.
Thank you.
I want you to take it off, though.
Why?
No, I'll not take off your clothes. Oh. I don't go that lane. I'm talking about, like, because here, I brought these. Look, I want you to take these off because I brought some makeup wipes. And, I figured we have a Today Show moment here on Nightcap. Show the clip of what I'm talking about while I help Beverly take it off.
You're saying, listen, I'm not telling other people to do it. This is my lane. This is what I choose at this moment. I love your husband going on social media saying, stand down, people. This is my woman, and this is what she wants to do. Well, the men in my life...
What's this about?
We got
she said,
wipes.
I'm going to join her this morning. Tamron said, I'm going to join her. And we said, that is
exactly
awesome.
How it
I think
went.
Y'all should join me.
Well, sure, I'm happy to.
Yeah. For some reason, really it's not much even, Alicia. What is it? Here.
Okay.
Come on.
If you help
come
me,
on
Alicia,
out.
I will do it only if you
it's
help me.
You don't have to.
No, I don't have to. I love you.
Shoot. And it's not for me. It's for you.
I love the message.
Feels great.
I love
and
the idea.
And I'm not stopping there. I'm telling you what. No.
You're so beautiful.
I will stop there.
Look at you.
But the message is
beautiful.
Who we
are now.
It goes beyond makeup, doesn't it, Alicia?
You don't even look like you have makeup on anyway.
Are you kidding me? I got a ton.
So.
Okay.
This goes beyond makeup.
No,
it's your heart.
Again, it's not about makeup and it's not about, look. I love makeup too, you know, and it's all good. It's about how you feel. It's about who you are. I mean, it's about just being who you are and not letting anybody tell you who you should be. And I think the other thing is kind of crazy. Even this conversation, it kind of shows our obsession of the standard we hold.
A standard
women,
of beauty, absolutely.
The standard of beauty.
Absolutely.
You get an extra half an hour in the morning now, right, to do something else.
To sleep.
To sleep. Okay, I'm doing this, and I need, here, help me.
Look
I can't see.
We'll finish it's this right here, and we're going to, you'll see this in the next segment.
Y'all crazy. Right.
Oh, I see. I have to be Alicia Keys to get you go bareface for all our nightcappers. Okay, well, I could be Alicia Keys. I'm just kidding. I got to be Devon. I can't be no one else but myself.
That was really terrible, but she's signing up for a great cause, but I like to have my
No, seriously, what do you think about Alicia Keys, no makeup, bare face movement thing?
I think it's cool. It's her own thing, some people feel like she's trying to say that, makeup doesn't define you or something. Mm-hmm. I don't know what she's trying to say.
She's not trying to say it. She's just saying she wants to embrace her beauty herself. And then on Twitter, I saw someone was like, it's a part of her promoting her album. Bro,
honestly,
no.
I don't know why she's doing it, but if that makes her happy, I don't see why not. And Swiss seems to like it.
And she's incredibly gorgeous. Yeah. But aren't you going to ask me what I think? I mean, I know that this is going to be... something that directly doesn't affect me, but just saying.
But we have
you
got
should,
some other
you should ask me how I feel about it because it's a serious
some
matter.
Serious even though NFL boycotts going on that we're talking
I mean,
talking
I'm
about
still stuck on it because I don't wear makeup because I'm naturally
wait, you're
beautiful.
You're supposed to say it with me that we're going to talk about in
why though?
Okay. Good.
It pains me to say this, but Bev is right. Now the tea we're about to spill about these next two boycotts literally made me burn my lip. Are you ready, Beverly?
I'm sure I am.
Are you ready, Nightcappers? Is everybody ready? Okay, so first up is NFL player and just heartthrob Colin Kaepernick, who did Rosa Parks, might I say. Before every game, there's the national anthem and the players stand up and they look solemn. Well, before a preseason game back in August, the 49ers quarterback refused to stand. After the game, he explained why, and here's what he had to say.
I'm not going to stand up to show pride in a flag for a country that oppresses black people and people of color. To me, this is bigger than football, and it would be selfish on my part to look the other way. There are bodies in the street and people getting paid leave and getting away with murder.
Kaepernick's move to sit down should come as no surprise, as he has been a staunch supporter of the Black Lives Matter movement and has often taken to social media to speak against the injustices of black people. I guess people thought he was playing around since it was a preseason game. But on September 1st, opening day of the NFL season, Kaepernick kept up his promise. This time he took a knee during the anthem. He said his decision to kneel instead of sit was out of respect for the military. This time 49ers safety Eric Reed joined him. Of course, his refusal to stand has people divided. And I am all for, people having their own opinion and expressing it, but there are some things that people say where you just have to ask yourself why though. E.g., for the lesser than that don't know, for example, GOP representative of Iowa, Steve King, who compares Kaepernick's activism to terrorism. Roll the dumb clip.
I think Colin Kaepernick is representing the San Francisco 49ers when he puts on that uniform, when he steps out on the stage, the world stage. He's taken advantage of that, and he's undermining patriotism. I understand that he has an Islamic girlfriend that is his fiance, and that this has changed him. He's taken on some different political views along the way. This is activism that's sympathetic to ISIS.
Okay, that video was a little bit too much. First of all, let me start off by saying, who does he think he is? That's one. And two, what does this have to do with anyone being Muslim? Mm-hmm. What Kaepernick is sticking up for is Black Lives Mattering.
Has nothing to do with Muslim people.
And plus,
nothing.
I'm not Muslim, so why you said I'm Muslim in the video? That was me claiming that I was Collins.
Okay. Wow, anyways. I just thought that was terrible. I feel like Colin has every right to express his First Amendment, right? Whether or not he wants to stand up for the national anthem.
Right.
Is his choice, okay? Does it say anywhere in his contract that he's obligated to stand up?
Nope.
Well, then nope. I see nothing wrong with it, and I'm all for people using their platform to do something positive and stand up for something.
And he's on a huge platform.
Yes. Standing up for social justice issues and bringing something to light that most people do not realize. You know, I've heard that the national anthem actually has a stanza that is like directed to slaves. Like, it's just terrible.
Yeah,
you know?
I heard it. They used to spread that around in school, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and it was like a heated debate about it once.
Oh, okay, well.
I just was there like, girl.
This is messy, right?
It's messy. It's messy.
Yeah. I also know that he's lost endorsements because of standing.
Which is ridiculous. He should be gaining more
yes.
endorsements for the simple fact that this is a strong message. But people have to open their eyes. It's a strong message.
His jerseys, I heard, are like hotcakes. They're just selling. They are selling like nothing. So that's great to hear. I will be copping mine next
They're
week.
They're like hotcakes. Okay. And now boycotting the NFL is actor James Woods. Now, I know some of you are at home and you're like, James who? Do you know who James is?
I have no idea. But I would like to know.
But he's one of those actors like, you know.
Wait, Woods. Like he, to know. I'm sorry.
You know him from movies because he's been in movies, but then you don't know you know his name. But when you see him, you're gonna be like, oh, that's James. Like, I bet when we show this picture, oh, that's James. right. Anyways, James Woods is furious with the way the NFL handled the Kaepernick situation and has vowed to never watch NFL again. That's what a lot of people vowed to do with James Woods' last failed show. Anyway, read what James told TMZ. Woods is referring to the statement the team released that neither praised or condemned Kaepernick. Let's take a look.
This coming down from the 49ers, the national anthem is and always will be a special part of our pregame ceremony. It's an opportunity to honor our country and reflect on the great liberties we are afforded as its citizens. And respecting such American principles as freedom of religion and freedom of expression, we recognize the right of an individual to choose and participate or not in our celebration of the national anthem.
Now, Beverly, what do you have to say about this?
Well, I really don't know who James Woods is, so quite frankly, I don't know why his opinion matters.
Ooh,
and I know
Colin
Kaepernick does not care what he has to say because he's standing up for the greater good. He doesn't care what anyone has to say about it. When you are true to something and you're really trying to stand up for something that you know will go further than just you like being on a football field and not standing up for a national anthem, you know that it's not just for you or for like the stadium or anyone who's watching, but it's for something more. It's for something that's happened in the past and something you want to change what moving forward. So I know that Kaepernick is not fazed by anything that Woods has to say.
But I know one way that you guys could remember James Woods. Do you watch Family Guy? Well, if y'all watch Family Guy, they constantly make fun of him and it's hilarious. But you know, just get him a check. So, I mean, for me, I just feel like I'm really proud of Colin. Mm-hmm. Despite about what anybody says, you know, it doesn't matter. Honestly, what matters is Black lives. And I know that a lot of people are starting to get offended because, you know, I'm a Twitter head. I'm always on Twitter. Shout out to Twitter, y'all. Tweet me. You know, a lot of people are saying, oh, but all lives matter. But, you know, there is a life that matters the most because, like, it's just, it's so legendary.
So question, if all lives matter, why isn't everyone outside boycotting and protesting?
She said it. She said it, not me. You take that up with the Twitter heads, okay? All I know is that Kaepernick is withstanding the fire like Shadrach and Meshach, okay? Nobody has time for it,
you know? I'm here for the Bible reference.
You already know what it is. And just in case you try to come for his dollars, Kaepernick said, if they take football away, my endorsements from me, I know that I sit up for what is
Absolutely.
Right. Okay, I hear that, okay? This next protest has me completely divided. Yes, there are some who are talking about boycotting the movie Birth of a Nation. I've talked about this movie before on Nightcap when it first premiered at the Sundance Film Festival back in January. The premiere at the festival shook the checkbooks out from companies like Netflix, Paramount, holla at me Paramount, Sony, holla at me Sony. However, Fox Searchlight Pictures, which I was surprised they got it, closed the deal at $17.5 million to acquire worldwide rights to this legendary movie. This deal made history because I think it was like the biggest deal at Sundance. So after the deal was closed, along with a bunch of others, waited and waited and waited and waited for a trailer. We really waited a long time. And a coming soon of the movie as well, it finally came in June, and with the release date of October 7th, now miraculously, mysteriously, conveniently, about 2 months after the trailer debuted and everybody's ready to go see, get my coin ready to go see it on October 7th, there was a loud buzz of all the awards this film will sweep. Headlines like these started to surface. Please show what has surfaced in the media. Yes, all of a sudden there is a renewed interest in a 17-year-old case in which the film's director, star, and writer Nate Parker was accused and later acquitted of rape when he was a student at Penn State. His college roommate Jean Celestin, who received a credit on the movie as well, was also charged. What do you think about this, Beverly?
What do you think about the timing? I just want to say I'm here for how he Tyler Perry'd this movie. Mm-hmm. He said, I'm going to write it, I'm going to star in it,
right.
I'm going to direct it, I'm going to produce it.
Because you know Tyler Perry be like,
I'm going to have my homeboy from college in it, okay?
Tyler Perry be like, Tyler Perry presents Tyler Perry's Madea's
exactly.
Tyler Perry.
Yeah, I think it was great that he did that,
yeah.
You know, putting himself out there. However, I do not think that what happened to him was a coincidence.
Coincidence? I think not.
Yes, I don't believe in coincidence. I think everything happens for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
And what they did to him was not cool. However, if it is true, it's unfortunate that it had to come out now during a time where like he's at the peak of his career and things are like going really well for him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he went from
yeah.
What's that movie called? Netflix.
It's not on
Beyond
Netflix. Don't be shady. It was on Netflix, okay? It was a great
Beyond
film.
The Lights.
Beyond
that
the
was
Lights.
An amazing movie.
Yes.
And that's like how he got like his rise to fame, right? That movie
yeah.
was awesome. So I'm glad that he used that platform where he realized a lot of people started to notice him to get out there and then start doing his own thing. Because
Noni,
I also
Noni feel
was not
like,
helping him. I'm sorry. No,
what did you say?
Noni from the movie.
What?
You know Noni.
Noni? I hate you. Oh, my God. Anyway, well, shout out to Gugu Mbatha-Raw. Don't shade her. I love her.
Oh, my goodness. How do you pronounce her name?
Gugu Mbatha-Raw.
I promise you, I knew her name, but like I didn't know how to pronounce it, so I was just like,
right. But I honestly feel like, you know, as soon as they heard Oscar involved in the black movie, they was like, oh, let's find something to like block this. Let's block this blessing. Because I'm really tired of every film that gets, I'm tired. Every film that gets nominated at the Oscars or wins at the Oscars and it has a black cast or it's about tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
It's just
True.
About straight up tragedy. I'm talking about Precious, 12 Years a Slave.
Did Selma get nominated?
Oh, Selma didn't get.
Oh, okay.
Selma, they just trashed it. Yeah, it got Best Picture, but it didn't win. It should have. But you know, that's really absolutely none of my business. Ava DuVernay should have got Best Director. Really, absolutely none of my business.
Ava's doing her thing. Let me just.
Y'all need to watch Queen Sugar
Queen
Wednesdays
Sugar.
At 10 on OWN. It's giving me life. Anyways, I feel like this is just really kind of blown up way too much.
Yeah.
I feel like this was his moment, you know? It's really important as a filmmaker to actually have people like go so hard for your movie and the reviews to be so great and like it'd be Oscar buzz. Like literally the Oscar buzz was happening as the Oscars had just ended.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, but even the woman's family smells something afoul because Look at the statement they made to the New York Times. She said, "We appreciate after all this time these men are being held accountable for their actions. However, we are dubious of the underlying motivations that bring this to present light after 17 years, and we will not take part in stoking its coal." Undoubtedly, the surfacing of this case has shifted the focus from the film to the filmmaker, which brings me to the question that I want to ask you, Bev. Can you separate the art from the artist?
All right, before that, I just want to say it's crazy because we talk about the whole issue of the alleged sexual assault, but we don't think about the person itself who was the victim. You know, like, we're over here thinking about Nate Parker.
It should be noted that the, you know, the woman who was, she 4 years ago, she committed suicide.
Oh, goodness, really?
Yes,
okay,
she
I didn't
did,
know that. So. That's really unfortunate. See?
Very unfortunate.
Yeah.
But it was very, I will say that it's very, I would say smart or just brave of her family to come out and make a statement like that. And they know what's going on.
They're bringing something up which they know the girl can't defend or say anything about. You know why? Because now, like, she's not here anymore.
They just took themselves out of the situation. Mm-hmm. But it's clear to see from their statement they know what we know. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
In regards to separating the art from the artist, I think it's possible to do for, like, until the artist does something so controversial when you're like, example. Azalea Banks is my hugest example.
Oh, my God. Can I go so hard right now? Can I respond to what you said?
People always tell me that she's a great... I've never listened to her
music. Her music... No, let me tell you something. She's fire. Mm-hmm. She's great. She can actually vocalize. She can't really sing, but she can vocalize. Her bars are crazy. If she got in a ring with Nicki, I think she would...
Oh, really?
I don't know. Like, they would go head to head. But she's awesome. I love Azalea Banks' music. I hate her as a person. She's a horrible person.
The things that come out her mouth, like, even the things that she tweets, it's just like... Who is your PR team?
Yeah, I feel like she's...
Who's her PR team?
Oh, she doesn't have a PR team because she doesn't have a label. So, yeah, and then another thing was, like, Chris Brown. Uh-huh. Separate the art from the artist. Like, I know in my household, they went hard for Chris Brown. Me, personally, I was like, that's horrible. Like, domestic violence is the worst. Mm-hmm. But his music, you can't deny he is one of the greatest R&B artists of our time. He's a really great entertainer. Like, I honestly think he's in the future, he's going to be a super legend. Mm-hmm. Or Justin Bieber. I mean, we could take it back to the time where he had said the N-word in his video. Did you ever see that video? Nightcap is, if you haven't seen that
which
video,
one?
Go back.
He
said, he was like, it's going to be one less lonely nigga.
Ooh.
Yeah, and then he was like, oh, if I kill you, I'm a part of the KKK. And they laughed about it. And it was
who
a video.
They?
And like the people in like the video, they all laughed.
Who's in the video?
It was like people behind the camera.
We need names, y'all.
We need names. But go on Twitter, because I'm always retweeting that video. It's messy. And you know, Usher tried to defend it before, but it's just like, at this point, you know, I love his music, but nah,
Usher,
son.
We love you. We need you to stop being this young man.
Yo, your album's fire,
you
boo.
You are not his father. We know you rose him to fame, but he is just, you know, not doing it.
And Usher,
anymore.
Michael Jackson's looking down on you like, I raised you,
anymore.
You know?
He's
you
not
don't.
16,
yeah.
You know? He's not that.
Is it too late now to say that we don't really care?
Boy, bye. All right, Devon. So when the show airs, are you going to go live on Facebook again?
Yes, I will go live on Facebook, and y'all could chat, and TT is... Because y'all know, y'all love... They be like, they come to... They be like, dame chichi. They want all the tea. So I will be doing Facebook Live.
Good, because I want to see what our viewers have to say. And a little birdie tells me that you also have some news to spill. So what's going on?
Yeah, well, I have some news. Mm-hmm. So, you know when I said I was going to CSI mm-hmm. and I announced it on the show? Well, that's a dub-a-dub-dub, 2 men in a tub, because I am going to be attending...
Did you just say 2 men in a tub?
Yes, I I'm going to be attending BMCC.
Nice.
Yes. Borough of Manhattan Community College, what's up? Shout out to my girl that was on the phone. You know, I love their customer service. Bomb, it's bomb. Just bomb AF. I love it.
So what are you going to be studying?
I'm going to be studying, obviously, performing arts. You know, their performing arts program is really, like, well-praised. Mm-hmm. And at first, a lot of people were like, BMCC, it's a community college. What are you doing? But it's like, it's not about that. It's about the education, and it's about the, I guess you would say, the richness
absolutely.
Of what I will get out of it. And mm-hmm. I've been to one of their shows. Actually, shout out to Louis. He was a guest on our show. He goes to BMCC, and he was in their show, and their show was sick. So I'm ready to go in there,
Devon,
and I'm ready to
say,
turn it out.
As long as you have a plan, that's all that matters. You have a plan, you know what you're doing, you'll be fine. It doesn't matter what anyone has to say about your education, because
exactly.
when you make it and you're doing your thing, they're all going to be like, Devon.
Right, I know.
How you doing, boo?
All up on my, you know.
Oh.
Sorry.
He ain't sorry.
Anyway,
you know, I remember when I was going through the process of finding a school, and I was told so many things from teachers, counselors, parents, and of course, friends. I just want to compare notes. So did you pick a school with a good name, or, you know, did you go for something that you personally liked yourself but didn't have to do with the name, per se?
You know, yes, I did, you know, at first.
Okay.
But then it kind of, you know, it just kind of, it was just like, you know, about the school after a while.
Mm-hmm. What you get from it, the substance, you're paying for your education. What are you getting from your education? You know, at the end of the day,
it's go hard, Beverly.
No, it's a diploma. People don't get it. It's a paper. You know, it just says, blah blah blah. Graduated from this place, this year, this date. You know.
Right. And it irked me a lot. It irked me a lot that that people would just be like, oh, it's the name, because I feel it is more important about, you know, find a school that's good for you rather than what a good name. Mm-hmm. For instance, BMCC, people say that it's not a good school. However, they have great performing arts program, as I said before, and I want to be an actor, and it's there for me. First of all, me and my girl, Leslie, shout out to Leslie, we was talking about it, you know, like, I just need to go for it. Mm-hmm. Like, no more wasting time, not worrying about, oh, but this and this and this and this. If it's great and it's good and it attaches to what I want, mm-hmm. I'm in there.
If it looks like a duck, it's a duck.
If it look like a duck, quack like a duck, then it's air flag. I don't know why I just did that. Okay, anyways.
Okay, I agree. One of the things I was told was to go to a school that was far away.
Yes.
However, the school I chose isn't far from home, and it's working out just fine for me. Well, here to join us is Ruby Reyes, who has some good stuff to say that is a slap in the face of what we've been told and probably what you've been told about higher education. Ruby has been working with teens for 15 years. She started out as a college counselor in Boston Public Schools. After a 4-year stint as a counselor, she began working at the City School, a grassroots nonprofit in Dorchester, Massachusetts, that seeks to strengthen leadership, development of teenagers through social justice education. Currently, Ruby is an associate with Powerful Pathways, a consulting firm, and continues to work alongside young people to advocate for themselves, each other, and our communities. Let me say, she's doing some wonderful things. Her resume
She about to slap she, in the face. Mm,
come on out here, Ruby.
Come on out, Ruby. Thank you for trucking all yes. the way from Boston to be on the show.
Absolutely.
How is your calf? Everybody, she injured her calf. How is it?
It's working now.
That's awesome.
How did it happen?
I was walking.
Oh, she just was
walking. I told you.
Her calf was tired. Yeah, her calf was tired. She wasn't, but her calf was tired. Ruby was scheduled to come on the show a while ago, but she injured her calf walking, like she said. So, but you're okay now, and you're here,
yes.
And we're ready to talk. Well, I am glad you finally made it. We're going to conduct this interview a little differently. So basically, we're going to let you rip. Just go off. Like, not OFF, but like OWF. Okay?
AWF.
Yes. We've chosen the most common pointers we've heard concerning college, and we're gonna let you respond and just go off.
Yes.
Just go off, okay? So, are you ready?
Whatever comes
ready.
To you.
Thank okay. you so much for having me, by the
yes,
way.
Yes,
sure,
it's a pleasure
we're
to
glad
have
you're
you
here.
And your calf.
You all
and your calf.
All the way from Boston.
All the way from Boston.
All the way from Boston.
Okay, so let's start with the ones we said earlier. You pick a good school, we should pick a good school with a good name. What do you feel about that?
I think it really depends on what your interests are as a student.
Okay.
And I think it really depends on a lot of young people, whatever direction they're going in. Some know exactly what they want to do, and then some don't. And so you, for instance, want to be an actor, you want to be a writer, so you're going to pick a strong liberal arts school.
Okay.
If you want to do media, you're going to pick a media communications school. And so those are the ones that you're going to pick because you're specialized. That's what you want to do, and those are your interests. I think a lot of young people should pick what they're interested in. If they're not interested in anything and they're not really sure where they want to go or what they want to study or you know, how to make the decisions, then there are plenty of schools that they can experiment with. So some of the community colleges offer a more affordable route of being able to experiment and see what they really want to study.
Mm-hmm.
College itself is it's a business. They're not really invested in you succeeding and doing well, they're invested in them making money. And so when you kind of put it in that frame of mind, you start to think about how your decision is based on the investment that you're making in yourself, in your education.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to be investing a lot of money in your education, then you want to know that you're getting exactly what you want out of it.
That's true.
And so, and that's not to say that the institutions themselves, they're very different from the people there. So the woman that you spoke to on the phone, she was very nice. She's a very nice woman. And so she's not thinking of you as, you know, a dollar sign. But the reality is that that's what education is in this day and age. It's a dollar sign. And so you're making the best choice on an investment based on what your needs are. And so when you think about it that way, it isn't necessarily the name of the school or the type of school. So if you're not sure, then maybe community college is a good route for you. And you can do it in a cheaper way. You do your first 2 years, you figure out, oh, you know what, maybe I don't want to do science. Maybe I'm more, you know, geared towards writing and you know, the liberal arts, and therefore, when you transfer, you pick a school that's heavier on that side.
Okay.
And so it really, it just depends on the young person.
Okay. Awesome.
All right. You should go to a school far from home. How do you feel about that?
I think it varies too. I think a lot of young people, they carry a lot of responsibilities at home. So some young people are taking care of family members, you know, maybe they have aging parents that they're taking care of, or they care for their brothers and sisters that are younger than them. So it really depends on each young person and what, you know, what their life circumstances are. If a young person, like I said, is helping at home a lot, then maybe they want to be closer to home. And then the other layer is the financial part. Living on campus is really expensive. It's anywhere from $10,000 to $15,000 a year easily. And so if you want to save on that, you can also pick something close to home and then just spend on transportation or spend on other things. There's a lot of costs that go into preparing for college that people don't necessarily think about.
Yeah.
You're gonna have to get a laptop, you're gonna have to get, you know, your books and all those things. And so you don't always think about those things. You don't think about, you know, the expenses of moving into a dorm, the expenses of having to transport back and forth. And so just being careful about your finances is really what determines where you should go and how you should go there. I think, you know, picking a school far away, you're going to be further away from your family. And if that's a huge support system for you, then maybe you need to think about that. If you've lived in the city your whole life and you want to try something different, then pick a school that's far away. Mm-hmm. But pick the right school that's for you, far
that's
away.
That's how I feel. Like, with anything, like, even with friends, like, we were all picking colleges. Like, I told my friends, no offense, but I'm picking the school that's right for me. I'm not picking because, oh, you're going, and I'm not picking because the counselor said, oh, this is a community college. I'm picking it because it's good for me. So, yeah, I'm glad you pointed that out. All right, so everyone should go to college, that comment. How do you feel about that comment when people say that?
I think that that's a very wrong comment. I feel that many young people, you know, it depends. If I've worked with a couple young people who told me that they didn't want to go to college, and I said, okay, what do you want to do? One of them said, I really just want to be a mechanic. And I was like, there's nothing wrong with that. The world needs mechanics, and they make good money, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. You could go two routes. You could go to a technical school, which would teach you how to be a mechanic, or you could talk to maybe your mom's mechanic and see if they'll let you work for them for, you know, a summer or the next year for free as an apprenticeship, you know, and then you'd be learning hands-on. So it just really depends. I think a lot of unions have, and, you know, unions are very controversial depending on which state you're in, but if you're in a union, they offer really incredible apprenticeship programs, carpenters unions, electrical unions, where you go and you apply and you do a training session and you're paid for training sessions, and then you work alongside long-time technicians. And so it really depends. I think a lot of young people, depending on what your strengths are, and I think it's really hard to make these decisions when you're 18 or 17.
Yeah.
You know, you're picking a career path for the rest of your life, or what you think is the rest of your life. And then you're also picking a financial burden for the rest of your life, because you're going to be carrying this finance. It's a really expensive choice to be making at 17 or 18 years old. And so if you're not ready for that choice, if you're, you know, if you're not sure what you want to do, and you know that you're one of those people that really wants to do something in the technical fields, then those are things that you need to consider. And that's very much a self-initiative piece, where a young person says to themselves, and it is hard to think outside the box, I think, with education, where you could go to your local mechanic and say, hey, can I work for you for the summer for free? Mm-hmm. You know, you don't always think of those things. And then the mechanic may, well, I don't know, young people, they don't work hard. I hear that a lot. But the reality is that you know, you could help each other out and it would be a win-win-win situation. Mm-hmm. And so even just posing that opportunity to, you know, a local person is something really different that maybe they hadn't considered before. And so you're taking the initiative and you're saying, you know, I'm really interested in learning about this. You know, can I spend the summer with you? I can work up to 15 hours a week or up to 20 hours a week. You know, this can be my schedule. And I think that's a different ask than, you know, can I spend the summer interning with you? So as long as you have a plan, and I think the same thing for young people that want to take a year off to figure out what they want to do, I think that that sometimes makes sense too. You know, and I think the layer of it is ensuring that you have a plan that you're presenting to your parents or that you're presenting to the people who are supporting you. Mm-hmm. So it's very different to say to your mother or father or, you know, your parents, I want to take a year off and I don't know what I want to do yet. I think that's a very different situation than saying, I'm not really sure if I want to go to college yet. I'm trying to figure it out. I'm going to work 40 hours a week at the place that I've been working in after school. And then on the weekends, I'm going to be doing research here, or I'm going to be working at this photography shop to see if that's what I want to explore more. Or, you know, I'm going to be watching films because that's what I'm really interested in, and therefore I want to go to a film school. Or, you know, just thinking about different things and presenting to them in a way that's your plan. Okay. And that you're sure of this is what you want to do.
Awesome, great. Another one, college prepares you for the real world. Do you think that's true?
I don't think that's true at all.
Finally, somebody said it.
I think a lot of, you know, it depends what field you're in. But for myself, I went to school for writing. Okay. And,
that's,
you know,
awesome.
Yeah.
Basic things like what does a letter format look like? You know, how to write a memo. Those are not things that are taught.
Was this a specific writing that you did, or?
I did print journalism.
Oh, okay, nice. Have you done any have you worked with any publications or?
Not really. I've been doing mostly grant writing and technical writing for the past 15 years.
Wow, awesome. Great.
Awesome. Yeah, I feel like college doesn't prepare you for the real world, because that's what my mom said the first day of high school when I was standing on the line. And goes, like, this is it. You have to be, this is the real world. No, I think that once you get out of college, that's when you really, like, you know, you click.
I don't really think so. I think the real world starts when you start to discover yourself and who you are, what you want to do.
That's true, too. That's
like,
true. I'm
then
sorry.
You're like,
now
whoa,
I agree
now
with
it's
that.
Real.
I do.
This is it. Like, I know where I'm supposed to be, and I know, like, why I'm here, so I need to go for it.
100%. I think a lot of it, too, is, you know, preparing for the real world isn't just about technical skills. It's also about people skills. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, the best advice I ever got, my mom said, you be nice to the receptionists and to the custodians, because they run the world. Mm-hmm. And it's really true. The nicer you are to the people who kind of make things happen behind the scenes, the further you're going to get ahead in life.
Definitely.
That's really true.
And that's not necessarily true, you know, just to disregard folks who are in charge and whatnot, mm-hmm. but the people that kind of like push your resumes through, or the people that you're nice to over the phone, that goes a really long way. Yeah. And I think that's not something necessarily taught in school. Like, the networking piece is taught, but it's taught in a very traditional, you know, I need you to help me get a job. What can you help me do? Mm-hmm. How can I help you get a job? Whereas, you know, that's not necessarily going to work. The investments that you make in your relationships that are authentic, real friendship relationships, that's what's going to get you a job. It isn't the, you know, networking luncheon where you're there selling your resume, giving out your business cards, and they're doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. It's the people that you have lunch with afterwards, mm-hmm. and have coffee with, and, you know, remain in contact with post-college, and kind of, you know, stay friends with, and, you know, and not because you expect something out of them, but because that those are the people that you made friends with, and those are the people you want to stay connected with.
I hear about many postgraduates who talk about difficulty finding a job. a lot of them were disillusioned because they were told a degree equals job opportunities. How do you feel about this? What do you think?
I think it depends on the job. I think a lot of jobs, if they require a bachelor's or they require an associate's, they'll post that. Yeah. But the reality is that you can get around it. And it's really about who you know. Yeah, the true. Jobs that I've gotten have been because I knew somebody. It wasn't because, you know, I had a degree. And not to say that my skills weren't aligned with the particular job either. But there have been jobs that I got that I, you know, I didn't know what I was doing. I felt like I didn't know what I was doing, but I asked for help. I said, you know, I feel like I need help in these three areas. Can you help me find support in these three areas? So I also knew how to ask for help. So I think the job market is about your authentic relationships. It's about your people skills. It's about your friends and who, you know, you letting them know what kind of job you're looking for. Mm-hmm. And then they mention, oh, you know what, this job came out, like, let me send it to so-and-so because I know they were looking for something in this field. Yeah. You know, actually, I know so-and-so in HR. Let me call them for you. And it isn't because you shared your resume or, you know, business card with them. It's because you guys had coffee or you were the nice person to them in college or, you know, whatever it was. That authentic relationship is really what gets it for you.
That's why I think it's good to be who you, like, be yourself all the time, 24/7, yeah.
Even if you don't know them, smile at them.
Yeah.
Yes.
My mommy taught me that. Well, I guess it's safe to say that you heard it here first, all of it, all of the tea from Ruby. Thank you again for coming, Ruby. So much fun having you. Such a good time. And she came all the way from Boston. Oh, my God. Well, you've given...
We don't like the Red Sox, but we like you.
And we don't like the Boston Baked Beans. I'm just kidding. Okay, you get a lot of information to me. I know that for sure. And I think a lot of you guys out there and our viewers feel the same way. We're going to give you all our social media info so you can tell us what are your thoughts on what Ruby said. And after that, we're going to have a good Nightcap spotlight.
Okay, I know we say this all the time when we come back from break, but if you missed the interview with career pathway specialist Ruby Reyes, you really, 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 really need to catch up with it when it re-airs or shut. Keep a lookout on it on our YouTube page. She had some really sage advice, not just about college, but about life in general.
Right, sage, no Gemini. So yes, yeah, like for real, she has some great advice, you know? Look at all that on the floor.
What?
Tate? No, that's all the tea and knowledge and stuff that she dropped on the floor and laid on us to let us know.
Clearly, we gotta watch our step because we don't want any.
We don't
want to
step on any of her truth.
Yeah.
Okay. In these streets. No, but it's whatever. Like Beverly, honestly, I'm about to have a soapbox moment.
Why?
Because I'm feeling emotional. Just bring it back. Let's get back here, Michelle. I had to spill my tea.
Okay. Destiny's Child reference.
Yes,
we love you, Michelle. Okay. Right, we don't have any hate against
but
you.
Honestly, this is my moment. One of the things that Ruby said that was really, really super important was that we need to be especially nice to the people who are behind the scenes who make things happen.
That's
so
true.
I want to give a deep, deep, heartfelt thank you to all of those who crew on Nightcap.
That's very true. Yes, we want to give a shout out to everyone
who's behind
the scenes. It is
not a duet. This is a solo moment, really. I want to thank Bana, Sasha, Maria, Roxlana, Giselle, and we are diverse here at Nightcap. So honestly,
diversity and inclusion, y'all.
Truly. We have two white guys that just changed the game in the most Caucasian ways, James and Micah. But they have their black card though.
Yes, absolutely. They were invited to the cookout. Micah
planned the cookout. It was actually at his house.
He did. He got a plate to go.
He lives in Harlem.
He was dancing. Did he? I think he electric slid at least once.
Like once.
Okay. Well, that was really touching, Devon. I'm glad you did that. Because, you know, it's good to give love to everyone on set.
Yes.
You know, whether you're in front of the camera
or behind the scenes.
It's
all about us though.
No, don't do that.
Don't get it twisted. But, you know, we love you.
Okay, so now that Devon has stepped out of the spotlight, we can put it on our musical guest. Yes, our Nightcap spotlight is 22-year-old singer and songwriter Noelle Kay, who hails from the boogie down Bronx. Don't clap because you're from Harlem. Noelle, believe it or not, says she started singing when she was in her terrible twos. Mm. We've definitely got to ask her about that. And it didn't take long for Noelle's talent to be discovered. In the second grade, her teacher heard her singing in class, and shortly after Noelle took the stage, for after her first of many performances, I just gotta say, her
she's
teacher,
selling
she is
records
nosy
from second grade.
As hell, okay?
Shout out to her teacher.
No,
hey,
shout
boo.
Out to her teacher.
I hope you watch.
After grade school, it was only fitting for Noelle to spend her high school years at LaGuardia High School, a.k.a. the fame school, a.k.a. where Madonna's daughter went
and
or goes.
And smoked cigarettes outside. That's not my tea.
Don't
you know?
Do that.
I met her before.
When she continued to develop her craft. From high school, she wanted to get her bachelor's in criminal investigation.
She's watching went to the college, girl, you know, so.
After college.
All the criminal activity going
Noelle
on.
Noelle decided to devote herself to her art. As a result of her dedication, Noelle released her first EP last year called The Notebook, No Nicholas Sparks, featuring true R&B tracks like So Anxious and The Breakup Melody.
I'm here for
Come
it.
Come on out here, Noelle.
Yes. Come on out.
Hey. How are you today?
Great. Thanks for coming. We're so glad to have you.
Thanks
for
joining
us. I'm so happy to be here. Aww, seriously, guys. Thank you.
So excited to have you.
Yes.
Love your music.
Thank
you. Let's chat.
Yes, we have to chat.
So let's chat. So, 2 years old. Tell us, you were singing at 2 years old. What were you singing? Temper tantrums? Like, what was it? Let us know.
Listen, I was singing Wu-Tang, Biggie, all that jazz. I was rapping more than I was singing, but yeah, you know, I mean, just anything on the radio, like singing the little lullabies and songs and Twinkle Twinkle Little Stars, all of that. But
that's amazing.
Yeah, my mom told me this. You know, I don't know nothing from when I was 2 years old.
No,
but yeah, my mom told me that's when, you know, she heard, okay, that's...
She's like, that was
yeah,
a no.
That was a no. My daughter is going to sing. Yeah.
Okay, so what did you sing when you were in the second grade? Because you, as you told us, your teacher overheard you singing.
Mm-hmm.
What was that like? What were you singing?
To be honest, I can't remember the exact song my teacher heard me singing.
Okay.
I just know I was in class one day, and Miss Blount, she heard me, and she said, nope, you're in the show. So the performance that we did, the play we put on that year, I sang Wind Beneath My Wings in the play, yeah.
Can we hear a little bit of that?
Let's get a little bit of wings in between, underneath our wings.
What?
I did it all wrong, but you know.
I can fly higher than an eagle, 'cause you are the wind beneath my wings.
I'm flying.
I'm throwing my edges. Flying.
Catch him. You're not gonna.
Put it back on.
But well, I'm sure you killed that performance because you just killed
it
here.
I was a little bitty girl.
Yeah,
but
still.
You still probably did incredible.
Thank you.
Yes.
But okay, so let's talk about middle school. Now, middle school, you started writing songs, and how did that come about?
Well, it was really from my dad. Like, my dad was a poet. He wrote all the time. Mm-hmm. He was a singer, too, but I didn't really know much about his, like, writing music.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote a song for me once. Mm-hmm. So that was later on, like when I was in high school, he actually wrote a cover to Usher's Superstar. But from young, like
Superstar.
It was more so back and forth between us doing poetry and writing different notes to each other. And I was just always writing. Like I loved English class. I loved all types of, even writing essays. Like that was just my thing. So I wasn't perfect. I'm not perfect now either.
Right.
Like I'm no, I'm no Neo or Timbaland or any of that. But like, I just really loved to do it. And then over time, just poems turned into songs,
Absolutely.
And then songs turned into just
art and life.
But you know what? You're really good at what you do,
Thank
and
you
that says
guys.
A lot.
So
much.
Can I ask, what was the first song that you wrote?
The first song I wrote was. First song I wrote, this song Ocean, I had to tweak the song. It's Ocean by 3LW. I did a cover to it, and I tweaked a little bit of the words. I used some of their lyrics, okay. But I tweaked some of it. So that wasn't my first full song, but that was the first song I actually like
Shout
recorded.
Out to
and
Three Little Women.
Yes, Three Little Women. I love
that
you.
Was petty. Did
no, it wasn't
say,
petty.
I said Three Little Women.
Shout out to 3LW.
Yes,
but yes, that's cool though.
Thank you.
So all the artists we've had on Nightcap, we ask a specific question, which is, what is the process when you write? What do you think, what inspires you to write? So I want to ask you exactly, what is it that drives you to write? Why do you write?
Why I write? I want to be in control of my own art.
Okay.
And to how I write is, most of the time, I have to hear the melody first. Mm-hmm. So whatever beats I get, I just zone out. I'm not conscious of what I'm writing until after I'm like, oh, this might apply to my life. Mm-hmm. And I think more so now I'm focusing on how it applies to my life and then connecting with other people. Okay. So I always want to relate to the next human being and the next human being and the next one. So I think that's just my thought process, and always, even though I want to be personal, let me be more general so I can apply to more than one audience.
Your first EP is titled The Notebook, and that's a really interesting title. Hold on, Rachel McAdams, not Nicholas Sparks.
A lot of inspiration from that, too.
Oh, really? So how did you come up with this? So tell me.
It wasn't necessarily the movie.
Okay.
But like I said, I like to relate. It was the book. But I like to relate. So when it was all coming together, I'm like, ooh. Not necessarily the whole entire script.
Absolutely.
The storyline of their story, but definitely my notebook was really it. Like, my notebook looks and has all the lyrics that I had from the EP in it. So it was just perfect. Like, I'm in this notebook, I'm reading through, and I'm like, what song should I do for this project? What song? And I had the diary, all a bunch of stuff. Like, my producer was like, it's not really working. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, the notebook. That's really what it was. So I'm like, ooh, and then I love this movie, and then it's a love story. But it was really, really personal.
Okay.
And it just came from the heart. It was really like how my diary of music, basically. And then I just dived into it.
And how long did it take to complete that project?
A year.
A year.
A year?
Wow.
For EP? How many tracks are on the EP?
It was 8. One of them I actually had to get cleared to put on by my friend. It wasn't my song. Mm-hmm. My friend Smalls, and I asked him
Shout
if I could
to
put...
Shout out to friend. Thanks for
letting friend.
Put the song
Thank
on the EP.
You. But yeah, he was so down to earth about it. Like, that was the first song we ever made together. That was his first song he ever made. So it was really, really huge to incorporate it. We performed it so many times. We did a show at Webster Hall, so I was like, please. And then he dropped an EP that same summer I did, and that song was on it too. So it was just only right.
Okay. Now you're currently working on your sophomore project, which is, I know it's a challenge for singers sometimes. It's a real hard challenge. So it's called The Unspoken Unity. Mm-hmm. What's the story behind that?
I went a little feminist there. It's an all-female EP. So I have 4 features on there.
Shout out to my feminists. Just had to say that.
I love the guys, though. I love them.
Yeah,
but,
I do, too.
But I had to do something for my girls.
Let them know.
Because that's just how it came about. Mm-hmm. Just with the songs that were coming up and people I was working with, that just all came into place. So I want to do a sequel to this project as well.
Nice.
The 4 females that are on there... Kimani, Vina Love.
Shout out to Vina Love.
We're actually shooting a video for the song that's on the EP this Sunday.
We'll be there this Sunday.
Yes, and Christiana Brooks and Fatima Yana. So
now,
I'm really excited.
I must say, because I love the title even more because of the feminine thing. So just want to say, because feminism is an unspoken unity.
Yes.
It's a unity that no one likes to speak about at all.
To speak
and that was
it.
No shade at all. It's just how the world
Us
works.
Women just don't realize how much we have in common. We're
That's
also
so
very
true.
Clicky. And I'm just like, no.
So when I see women fighting,
barriers.
I'm like, don't do it.
Break them. Like, even girls who walk down the street and look at each other, the stale faces.
Yeah.
The little shade throwing.
Do you know we think a lot alike? The decisions we make a lot of times.
We are getting paid the same.
He's saying we like.
Or that
No, I'm saying we like
we
in your thoughts.
In my thought process.
I'm a guy.
I got him.
Obviously.
But yeah, like, just common things that women, little girls yes. to mm-hmm. preteens to adults.
Yes.
Just the whole idea that we don't unify enough. So this mm-hmm. project is kind of touching on how it starts, like the insecurities we go through, where they stem from. No offense.
And
us
that's
guys.
Beautiful.
The guys, they
I don't got nothing to do
they
with
bring
that.
They bring it out a little not. Bit. They bring out the evil in us sometimes. Mm-hmm. But there's good and bad with everything. Yeah. So I want to touch on all those things. Yeah. So starting from the beginning is like, and the end with Off My Mind with Vina is just like, girl, I like you. We doing this and we going to run with it. And that's just where I wanted to like go.
That's
so everything
beautiful.
In between, I won't tell y'all. But
okay. Honesty is the best policy. Yes.
Well, I'm really excited to hear
Me
that.
Too.
So it
excited
sounds like
to
it's
going to
be bomb. You have
it's
all these people
tea.
In here for
Thank
it.
You. Yeah.
It's
Thanks,
the
guys.
So how would you say that this EP compares to the first?
Ooh. Just even the direction of where I was going. With me talking on the notebook, I was talking about a relationship, a guy. A lot of inspiration came from my guy, but I was talking about that. So now I'm talking about general things. Okay. So that's the difference in the two, is just the direction of where it's going. Forget there that. Will be a little boy is mine kind of conflict on there.
Don't talk about boy is mine. Don't do that.
Because y'all know.
Like, no.
Boy is
no.
mine. Yes.
There's a little Brandy Monica kind of thing going on.
Oh, don't say
on.
Brandy's name on this show.
Don't say. Just.
Just no.
He's going to explode. He's going. He loves
that's
Brandy.
The gag,
Listen,
kid.
She's. One of my idols. So.
Brandy?
Brandy. So. Brandy.
You're like
yes.
his best friend now.
Where was that?
Okay, so where can viewers find you on social media?
I just started my music page on Facebook. Just formulating my business and my branding. Okay. It's Noelle K Music. You can search that in the search box. And on Facebook, like it, follow me. That's where you can find all of my like updates for shows, new music releases, mm-hmm. my video links, all that jazz, pictures, all that. My Instagram, noelle_k. And Twitter, lyrically_write, R-I-T-E, not R-I-G-H-T. And yeah.
Okay. Well,
there you have it.
Well, we will be following.
We
well,
love
I followed
okay.
her on Instagram today.
Yes.
So.
Boom.
Yes.
Boom. And I will be too in these streets. And you can like it and you
okay.
can get
yes.
both the notebook and the upcoming
Unspoken
Unity.
Is dropping
so here for
this
it.
Fall. Might be this month. So October.
So you go on our Facebook page, watch our stuff, and you know tell. No, Noelle, no tell. What you think about Miss
oh,
Noelle
K? Oh, my YouTube.
Yes, YouTube. What's your YouTube?
Noelle K.
Okay.
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 Thanks for no telling us your YouTube.
I'm okay, sorry, guys.
I think that joke's dead.
Yeah. You kind of drank it.
SoundCloud, okay. I'm a mess. I got so much stuff. My SoundCloud. Y'all. Noelle K. Murr, M-U-R-R.
Okay.
At the end. And you could just search my... It's connected to my music videos. It's connected to my SoundCloud, all of that. All
okay,
that.
So let's recap. We have Instagram. We have Twitter.
Facebook. Yep.
SoundCloud.
Mm-hmm.
YouTube. Good.
All good.
Five.
And boom, and you can go listen and listen. Y'all think Check y'all listening out. To real R&B. But the gag is, she's right here. Okay? So go get some Noelle K. Thank you for watching Nightcap.
Thank you. See you next time.
Bye.
Bye guys.
Here's a gift from me to you. Don't tell me what to do, boy. See, what I'm giving you may be cruel, boy. But I just can't lose, boy. See, I done changed shit. Everything that I've arranged here. Didn't plan on it before I came here. Opportunity showed up and then it rained here. Such a shame, dear, that I had to stunt on the main. I wanted a baby with maybe 10 kids. Giving all of my eggs in a basket. It was tragic, and all I asked is for your honesty. All the time that you promised me, no discrepancies, 100% trust you see. All I ever got was these bitches testing me, disrespecting me, calling it bluff. You saying, baby, please don't leave. Leave your attitude, did everything to get back with you. You ungrateful brat, and you want a piece of me. Boy, I'll embarrass you, so don't tell me what to do, boy. See what I'm giving you, and maybe. be cruel, boy, but I just can't lose, boy. Don't play with me, don't be dishonest. Still not understanding its logic. Hey, I'm back in the middle, yeah. I won't be mad as ever. I wanna give you better, but you just made me give up. Get down with another mix-up, cause I'll be damned if I let you give up before me. Before I give up on you, I just can't lose you. Yeah. Here's a gift from me to you, yeah. Now, this is from my upcoming EP, Unspoken Unity. It's releasing this fall. I love this song. It's featuring one of my favorite girls, Christiana Brooks, but this is a solo show today, so she couldn't join me. I can't wait for you guys to hear the song. What's your name, young boy? Cause I've been checking all night long for you. Come a little closer, baby. Come on, baby, tell me your name. I don't approach most guys. Time after time, they're watching me. I stay away, I friend zone, baby. I'll tell you again and again, I don't approach those guys. Calling my name down the street, but when I saw you, I really had to meet you, baby. I really had to meet you, something crazy. I've just been feeling around town waiting for you. I've just been been around town waiting for you. I do know you. You've been watching me, I've been watching you too. What's your name? What's your name? One more time, y'all. What's your name, young boy? Cause I've been checking all night long for ya. Come a little closer, baby. Come on, baby, tell me your name. I don't approach those guys. Time after time, they're watching me. I stay away, I friend zone, baby. I'll tell you again and again, I don't approach those guys. Calling my name down the street, but when I saw you, I really had to meet you, baby. I really had to meet you, something crazy. I've just been feeling around town waiting for you. I've just been feeling around town waiting for you. I do know you've been watching me, I've been watching you too. What's your name? What's your name? Waiting for you.